Sunday follow-up for January 7th. We are celebrating the baptism of our Lord. This is the first Sunday after Epiphany. Epiphany is January 6th. And so that is the celebration of the coming of the Magi. And then the celebration on January 7th, the Sunday, the first Sunday after Epiphany, is the celebration of the baptism of our Lord. So our texts for today are Genesis chapter 1, Romans chapter 6, and Mark chapter 1. Now, again, like I think I said last week, I preached on the Psalm 29 this week. So we'll go over that just a little bit right at the end. But I want to start off with, of course, the main theme of the day, which is the gospel lesson. Then we'll move on to, again, the theme of baptism in Romans chapter 6. And then finally to creation and new creation aspect of Genesis chapter 1. So, as we usually do, we just go through the text, we read it, and I tell you insights into it to try and follow up on whatever you might have heard this morning, maybe give you a little bit more insight. And if you're in the Kick Chat live, you can actually send me a message and I will answer it. But if you're not in the Kick Chat, then I probably won't answer your question until maybe eventually when I see it. All right, so we are looking at Mark chapter 1. This is only the fourth verse, so this is very early. I mean, Mark basically starts his gospel with John the Baptist coming on the scene. And then one of the major things that John the Baptist does is baptize Jesus. So we start off with verse 4. John appeared baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And he preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." And we're going to stop there and we're going to discuss this, because I think we actually discussed part of this before in the wilderness, being, of course, the outer reaches, so to speak, the rural areas around the Jordan River, not metropolises. And he was proclaiming a baptism for the repentance, baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. So this is a baptismal of repentance. This is where you would wash yourself with water in order to cleanse yourself from your previous sins. But again, as you go on sinning, you would do it again, just like a sacrifice or a sin offering would be made for all your sins. Repeatedly, you would do this. Now, one of the major things that's great about Mark chapter 1 is that Mark uses this identifier. All the country of Judea and all of Jerusalem are going out to him and were being baptized by him in the Jordan River. Now, this is great because this is hyperbole in one sense, but it's also explaining more about what the significance of the baptism is. Because these are baptism of repentance. So the idea is that when you go down into the water, you wash your sin. And where did your sin go? Just like the dirt goes into the water. And so this water is now mucked, dirtied in some sense, with all the sins of Israel, all the sins of Jerusalem, all the sins of the country of Judea. All the people's sins is mucked in that water. So then, when Jesus comes and goes down into that water, he doesn't have sins to wash away, but rather he takes up those sins of the world upon himself. It's an interesting concept and imagery to recognize that Jesus, just as in his birth, he took on human flesh to take on our way of living and our way of being. Here, He takes on our sins that have been confessed, our sins that have been repented of, and he takes those sins and he gathers them together and he places them upon himself, just as he placed our flesh upon himself, and he will then carry our sins and carry our griefs and carry our burdens to the cross, where he will ultimately die for the forgiveness of all of our sins, wiping them all away. And that's part of the significance of that, all the country of Judea and all of Jerusalem going out to him. Yeah, it's a hyperbole, but it's also theologically defining that Jesus takes all the sins of the world upon his shoulders. John wore clothes of camel's hair and a leather belt, fairly simple and straightforward, ate locusts and wild honey. Locusts are a type of grasshopper. Wild honey is honey that you find in the wild. Most likely you'll get stung if you take too much honey in the wild. He preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandals I am not worthy to stoop down and untie." And this is one of the things, is that the gospel, Mark's gospel, doesn't shy away from identifying that John the Baptist is lesser than Jesus, right? This is a part of this lesson to understand that when Jesus comes to John in Matthew's gospel, right, John wants to refuse him because he knows that he is unworthy. But no, you do this to fulfill all righteousness. And part of fulfilling all righteousness is, again, that Jesus needs to go into those waters and he needs to take that sin upon himself. And then finally, in this part of the text, John identifies himself as the one who baptizes with water, just water. "But he who will come after me will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." That's different. Baptized with water and baptism with the Holy Spirit. It doesn't change the definition of what baptism is or how baptism is done, but there is a baptism of a washing of water that is just water. And there's a baptism that is done, which is a washing of water, which is imbued by or enforced by or supported by or grounded by the Holy Spirit. And that's the baptism that is once and for all. Baptizing with water, that you need to do as you sin more, you need to be baptized again. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is a one and done baptism. "I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." That's a baptism, one and done. All right, now, verse 9, the actual baptismal narrative. "In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn open, ripped asunder." I can't remember when I was talking about this text before, but again, that God would rend the heavens and come down. This is the rending of the heavens and the Spirit descending on Jesus like a dove. The Spirit descending, showing tangible proof that this is truly the Son of God. This is the rending of the heavens, and he comes down in the person of Jesus Christ. And a voice from heaven affirms this then. "You are my beloved Son, with you I am well pleased." One of the tricky things and differences is that immediately he saw the heavens being torn open. Who's the he there? Now, when it says when he came up out of the water, that he is specifically Jesus. The other he is most likely, again, Jesus. But is this Jesus the only one who sees the rending of the heavens and the Spirit descending in the voice? Or is this all the crowd? Or is this Jesus and John? And from John's gospel, not John the Baptist's gospel, but John the Evangelist's gospel, it would indicate that John saw this tearing of the heavens and the Spirit descending like a dove. Now, and it could be particularly associated with Jesus saw it, could be particularly associated with John seeing it. But either way, one last thing, the coming up out of the water, some people associate this line with some sort of immersive baptism, which again, for historical purposes, most baptisms, most mitzvahs, not like a bar mitzvah or bat mitzvah, but a mitzvah, if I got that term right, of a cleansing of water, a purification ritual, was generally done by, again, fully submerging yourself. And once you're fully submerged, they would say clean. And then you'd get up and you'd do it a couple of times to make sure you were clean or holy again, I guess. But that's, again, a water baptism that's a Jewish custom as well. But here, the coming up out of the water does not necessitate, the language does not necessitate the coming out of from below the surface of the water. Because just like when I get out of the pool, doesn't necessarily mean, it means I came up out of the water, but it doesn't mean that I was fully submerged at any time during my swimming activity. Or similarly, if I get out of the pool and it's a kiddie pool, I definitely was not submerged, but you would still have the same idea of coming up out of the water. Or if I'm walking along the shore line and then I decide to go out of the water, right? I come up out of the water. So that this language does not necessitate a immersion baptism. And in the same regards, like I said in those cases, but that doesn't mean that it couldn't have been an immersive baptism. But really the point is that it doesn't necessitate. There's nothing that necessitates a full immersion style baptism. Similarly, there's nothing that necessitates what type of water this is, but that it's water. So what makes a baptism? Water and the Word of God. Talk more about that later. But this is the basics of the text, and I don't know if any of you have questions. That's great. You can drop them in the Kick Chat, or you can drop them in the YouTube chat later. We're going to move on to Romans chapter 6. What shall we say then? Are we to continue to sin so that grace may abound? By no means. And if you don't get that, if you can't get that, I feel sorry for you. I mean, I absolutely feel sorry for you. Because that, in and of itself, is such a simple idea. What then shall we say? Are we to continue in sin that grace may abound? By no means. So what is the life of a Christian supposed to look like if by no means we're to continue in sin that grace may abound? It means we're constantly in a fight to stop sinning. We're constantly in a battle against sin and the power of sin to control our lives, to work in our lives. We are constantly in a battle and a fight for our life, for our reality, for our identity in Christ. That we are constantly in this fight to make sure that we are fulfilling our baptism. Well, one of the things that I've talked about previously, not on Kick or YouTube necessarily, but previously I've talked about the idea that somebody once said, you know, telling kids or telling people to act their age as if they're supposed to act more grown up or more mature as they grow, right, really doesn't make any sense. But to tell Christians to act their baptism means to go through the Ten Commandments, means to identify yourself as a full Christian, and how does a Christian behave? And that doesn't mean you have to go into pietistic identities or you have to go into pietistic legalism or any sort of thing like that. But what it does mean is that we're constantly striving against sin and we're not giving in to sin. Which really goes into our lifestyle. So we shouldn't have a lifestyle of sin, by no means, right? We shouldn't continue in sin so that grace may abound. We shouldn't sin just to sin, or we shouldn't sin because it makes us feel good, right? No. So how can we who died to sin still live in it? By all means, answer that question. How can you who have died to sin in the waters of baptism still continue to say, well, I'm just going to keep on living in it? No, you've been changed. You've been transformed. You've become a new thing, a new creation in the waters of baptism because you've been connected with Christ and his death. I should let Paul go on. Do you not know that all of us who have been baptized into Christ Jesus were baptized into his death? We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. Exactly. We were buried with him and we were raised with him to walk in newness of life. That's a purpose clause. We too might walk in newness of life. That we too might walk as Christ walked. That we too might be holy as thou art holy. That we too might live that sanctified and good life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. We know that our old self was crucified with him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing, so that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. Right? The release from sin and slavery, the release from our enslavement to sin, right? This is a good thing. This is a solid thing. This is a thing to strive for. And similarly along these lines, right? The old self was crucified and the body of sin might be brought to nothing, right? That's a part of baptism. It's a part of the baptism of shedding off that old sin and being made anew or renewed once again. Being a new creation. For one who has died has been set free from sin. So if you died to sin, you've paid your price, the redemptive price, and therefore you're free. Now, if we have died with Christ, we believe that we will also live with him. We know that Christ, being raised from the dead, will never die again. Death no longer has dominion over him. For the death he died to sin once for all. But the life he lives to God. So you also might consider yourselves dead to sin and alive to God in Christ Jesus. And this is exactly the point. We need to recognize that we are dead in our sins and are dead in our trespasses and dead in our unholy actions. And we are alive in Christ Jesus. That we are renewed in Christ Jesus. That we live in God. We live by means of God and by means of his gracious gift of his son, Jesus Christ. That's it. There's some other connective things of free from sin, living in sin, all these things that do connect with like Romans 7, Romans 8, Romans 9, and so forth. But this is the basic starting point, I guess. I don't really know what else to get into, but Paul does, you know, here as he identifies this, remember, Paul is being general. He's not picking on a particular sin. So most people in the conservative Christian church body will pick on things like adultery, pick on things like homosexuality, pick on things like abortion, pick, you know, identify those clear sins that have culturally become lifestyles and seen as, well, they're just lifestyles. So they're not in particularly sinful. Similarly, though, you have to recognize bullying or picking on someone or ruining someone's reputation is also a prominent lifestyle. The people have made big money. People have made promotions. People have made a lot of effort over tearing other people down, by whether it's news media, by whether it's just general talking amongst friends, however they may be doing it, right? There is a sense and there is a reality in the fact that people can tear one another down. People can actively live a lifestyle of false witness. Similarly, people can also make a lifestyle out of stealing from others. And not just stealing in the, and I'm not just talking about stealing in the sense of fraudulent gains or stealing in the sense of interest rates or stealing in the sense of usury or stealing in the sense of being a kleptomaniac, right? There are also people that find themselves living in a lifestyle of stealing from people by maybe not giving them their due reward for their service, maybe not looking out for their assets as well as they're looking out for their own assets. Maybe it is a matter of actually stealing land or stealing property or stealing ideas from other people, not paying them for their full usage. And maybe some of it we see as negligible. You know, how much did I really take from this company? Or how much did I really take from this guy? Or maybe even when I went through the line and the guy gave me an extra quarter of change, it's not that. But that becomes a part of your lifestyle. But it's still a sin, right? You still stole. You can't get around that. You know, if you're stealing stuff, you're stealing stuff. It doesn't matter how big or how small. And then you can even think of, so that's ruining people's reputation, gossips and so forth, stealing in pittance or stealing and taking away or stealing and tricking, all sorts of different ways in which you can steal from someone. And then you can go into pornography and all sorts of sexual abominations that people think are so casual or normal, again, but they're not. So Paul doesn't go into this list of abominations. Paul doesn't go into the list of sins. Why doesn't he? Because he knows that you, as the reader, are going to know your Old Testament. You're going to know the law of God. You're going to know what God actually expects from you without him having to list it all for you. That's the big part. So, are we to continue in sin so that grace may abound? By no means. We should try and avoid sin at all costs. But is there a war waging within us in Romans chapter 7? Absolutely. Do we need someone that's not going to condemn us no matter what in Romans chapter 8? Absolutely. But that doesn't mean we give up. All right. Genesis chapter 1. Genesis chapter 1, here you have, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Again, I contend that this is an introduction, that this is God telling you exactly what he's going to tell you, and then he tells you, and then he tells you again in Genesis chapter 2, rather than this is the actual creative act of beginning that leads into verse 3. But then it really goes into how do you view verse 2. The earth was without form and void, and darkness was over the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. So the idea would be is that if you take verse 2 in correlation with verse 1, then you see it as God created the heavens and the earth, but he hasn't finished the act of creating. So he sees the darkness, he sees void, he sees emptiness, he sees things that he needs to fix or make right. And so what does he do? He has the spirits hovering over the waters, which recognizes that the ball is a ball of water, right? The earth is water. And it still basically is today. And God said, let there be light, and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness, and the light he called day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning the first day. So, is the light from the darkness kind of completely separated from verse 1? Or is it connected with verse 1 through verse 2? In which case, there's darkness over the face of the deep. We're going to create light. We're going to create light so we can see what we're doing. Or does God first create light and then on the second day create waters that separate above and below, which again is creation of the water and creation of the water above and below and whatever else is needed for, again, the follow-up to the waters gathered to one place and there become land, right? And if all the waters were in one place, then where is all the land? One place, right? That would make sense. That it doesn't make sense that there would be seven continents if all the water was gathered together in one place. So how do we get seven continents? Well, you have to read the rest of the story. Let's see. What else do we need to talk about here? Light and the darkness. Epiphany is about the season of light, which is why this is focused just on verse 1. Instead of going all the way through Genesis chapter 1 and the 7 days or 6 days of creation, the seventh day resting. The light separated from the darkness. The light is called day, which is daylight, which is the light you see during the day. And the night is the darkness, which you see at night. Makes sense? Then you have this cardinality of first day. First identifies that you're actually dealing with this first full cycle, because there's a cycle of evening and morning. Now here again, people can argue whether this is a 24-hour literal day, or they can argue whether this is 1,000 years, or you can argue whatever you want to for this extent of what a day is. But here's the kicker. I don't care whether you want to argue for 24 hours, or I don't care whether you want to argue for 1,000 years or multiple years or some general vague timeline. But there was evening and there was morning. That you can't get around. There was evening, which is night, and there was morning, which is the dawning of a new day. The first day. That's quite clear. There is evening and there was morning the first day. That's what you got. You don't get to say that, well, there was a huge cycle of life and death or huge cycle of generations in the first day. Nope. Nope. No. And neither for any of the other days. You don't get to say that because there's evening, there's morning. There's a light and dark cycle. Now, whether you want to say that that light and dark cycle was 30 hours or maybe it was 36 hours or maybe by some stretch of the imagination it was 48 hours of a cycle of light and dark. But I'm guessing, just based on what I know, that it's very close to a 24-hour literal day because of everything I know about light and darkness cycles of the creation. And that's why light and dark were separated. The light is separated to be day and the darkness separated to be night so that we would have light and darkness on one day. So That's my little spiel for first day of 6 days creation. I emphatically believe in a young Earth, younger than even some people would say. Evening, morning, 6 literal days creation. Again, if you want to say that they were a little longer than 24 hours or a little shorter than 24 hours, I don't have a problem with that. But you can't really get away from close to 24-hour days. And that means you'll still only have 6 of them. You have 6 daylight night periods. That's quite clear. All right. That should wrap that up. The psalm is basically about the voice of God and so the power of the word to again, bring judgment, thunders of the waves, powerful majesty, flames of fire, breaking things, stripping the forest, all that stuff, dealing with the voice of the Lord and the power of the voice of the Lord in judgment. Then you have Lebanon and Syrian, like newborn children. You have the temple, all at the temple crying glory. And of course, you have the new birth in the birth of a deer. So all that imagery is there. And then verse 10 connects with the flood, which in 1 Peter chapter 3, Peter connects the flood to baptismal waters. So very, very baptismal psalm focused. All right. I'm going to go over, if you want to end the video there, I'm going to go over on my YouTube to actually see if anybody left a comment from before, because I tell myself I'm going to check these before, and I never do. Comments. Are there any comments? No comments. All right, so we will say bye. I am Darth Dave, and I generally stream video games on Kick. I do this for Sundays on YouTube. I might try and do some Bible study stuff, but again, I'm not really. I got some conferences to come up, so we'll see how those go. Have a good week. Have a blessings on your season of Epiphany.